I'm Van Savage. I'm a professor at UCLA in the departments of computational medicine and also ecology and evolutionary biology. And I'm an external faculty here at Santa Fe Institute.
I'm Geoffrey West, and I'm on the faculty here at the Santa Fe Institute.
I'm Alexander Herman, and I'm an assistant professor of psychiatry at the University of Minnesota. And I spent a couple of years here as a graduate fellow many years ago.
Well, it's titled, What is Sleep? So that is the big question we're out to explore. But I think specifically trying to get it from a more functional, sort of all-encompassing theory kind of perspective, like what the main drivers are, how does that fit, how does it look across species?
Yeah, because sleep is one of these extraordinary phenomena that dominates, you know, a third of our lives, and yet there's no accepted generic theory for the origins of sleep and the need for sleep. And part of this meeting is to address those questions, and then playing a foundation for some of the biomedical questions associated with sleep.
The idea of these questions came about from when I was a postdoc at Santa Fe Institute a long time ago and talked with Geoffrey about them, and Alex was here in RU, and we all started working on these questions. And we always wanted to have, like, you know, more conversations among these different parts of the sleep field and ourselves. And then when the Complex Time working group series came along, it's a very natural fit because sleep is all about time. There's time scales from, you know, milliseconds or even shorter perhaps, up to, like, you know, evolutionary time scales for the origin of sleep. So it both covers huge ground in terms of time scale, and it involves coupling together of lots of different time scales. So it seemed just like a natural fit and opportunity.
Pretty wide range of disciplines, I think. Everything from circadian biology to molecular neuroscience, systems neuroscience, physics, applied math and mathematical modeling.
You said more clinical too?
Yeah, some clinicians, clinical sleep researchers.
Well, I think one of the things that we've been discussing is because we want to find a synthesis of all these many different ways of looking at sleep and exploring sleep, is to have either or both a synthetic book that expresses the outcomes of the kinds of discussions that we've been having, but also hopefully a sort of punchy one or two page paper in a high profile journal like Science or Nature to both express kind of this more SFI view of sleep as more synthetic and integrative, but also to bring to the attention of the more general public the central role of sleep in our lives and some of the big questions associated with deleterious effects coming from dysfunctional sleep.
So I think one of the nice things about meetings like this is it forces you in a very SFI sense to step back and ask the big questions. And so we sort of came up with a list this morning of 10 to 15 questions that include things like, if sleep serves multiple functions, can we make a tree of, like, which Alex suggested, of, like, which species, like, this function is more important for during this life stage, like when you're a baby, this is more important, when you're an adult, this is more important. And can we, you know, again, in a very theoretical, physicsy, quantitative way, like, calculate, you know, real numbers for that, not just be, like, hand-wavy heuristic, but actually say, like, this, you know, percentage goes to this and this percentage goes to that. Also, one thing I find really interesting, and you two can comment on other ones, one of the questions I find really interesting is if it does serve multiple functions for sleep, I'd often thought of them like sort of all happening together harmoniously. But more and more from this meeting, I'm thinking about them sort of, you have this chunk of time you sleep, and they're all trying to compete for that time to serve the function they need. And so if they're competing for time, how does that competition work? And what gets primacy? And what's the time scale for that competition? Things like that. That's been a new perspective for me.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the interesting exercises we did at the end was to make an inventory of all the possible functions and consequences of sleep we could imagine. And I think one of the things that gave me insight into is that you can either get very lost in the weeds and the details of these things and get bogged down with each individual very specific case and what sleep, you know, means in this very specific case. But if you are able to move kind of back and forth across scales, so zoom in and zoom out, you can see that maybe there actually are commonalities, universal themes that emerge, even when you consider, you know, such a comprehensive, very diverse inventory of possible functions. And so one of the interesting things we talked about at the end was that, you know, one way of conceptualizing sleep is that all of these various functions that occur in the brain, across the body, even across a population, sleep is serving potentially some role in optimizing each one of them. And so, what are the cost functions that might be associated with optimizing those processes? And is there some small set of cost functions that can lead to an optimal solution for all of them? Or does each one require its own equation? And I think you only get that kind of insight and perspective when you really put people together who are coming from all these different fields, together with theoreticians who are used to kind of assimilating lots of details and then starting to think what cuts across all of this potentially theoretically and mathematically.
For me, I mean, when I think time, I think of sort of the physics definitions of time, but when I think complex time in this context, I actually think it's something, this is in my head, sort of my more like complex clocks, where there's, again, for sleep, we have clocks inside of us for like circadian rhythms, for this, you know, how much total sleep we need. So we have lots of little clocks inside us, but so do other species, so do, you know, there's everything else going on, and we have to sort of interact with all these different clocks at once and coordinate them somehow. And that's a very complex systems type of question for how does that work.
So time, yeah, so complex time to me means the kind of emergent time that we're not conscious of, a little bit taking off from what Van said, that across species, timescales of the same phenomena change in a systematic way. And so, you know, that's why all the scaling laws come from. They're all that if you look through the right lens, everybody's living the same life. I mean, even though a shrew may live for a year or two and a whale for 120 years, but actually they're, if you sort of stretch out the shrew's life, it sort of maps onto the whales, I mean, in a very coarse-grained way. And that is sort of, that's a time that we don't see. And we're so dominated by astronomical time, the rotation of the Earth and the Earth rotating around the Sun, and Newtonian ideas of this sort of fixed thing called time, that we don't see that. And just, you know, on the other end of the spectrum, we have social time, time that we develop by our own social interactions. And that's a different kind of time. And that time, you know, we know is speeding up. I mean, life is actually getting faster. It doesn't just seem to, it actually does get faster. And these are emergent phenomena that come about because of the underlying dynamics of these within these systems. And sleep is one of these, and one of the more mysterious ones, actually. And I think one of the things that, in terms of the complexity of the issue and the challenge that was stressed in here, which I think is still debatable, frankly, is that, sleep is expressed somewhat differently across different species, even across different mammals. And I think that's a question yet to be examined. I mean, I think that's the general feeling, but I think, you know, from where we normally come from in terms of the concept of a complex time is looking for the commonality that transcends these differences. So sleep is a particularly interesting example because it does show so much, apparently so much variance.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have too much to add to that, but I guess I would say, to me, the notion of complex time, what's really profound about it is that time, which we think of as this unitary arrow with one, you know, one pace, one scale, is fractured actually across multiple time scales. And there are nonlinear processes, dynamics operating on all these multiple time scales. And yet somehow coherence emerges from that. And it's really hard to believe that, given the fact that there is such a wide range of different timescales which seem fundamental to whatever particular process you're thinking about at that moment, all the different clocks that we have operating inside our own bodies, from cellular clocks to whole organism clocks and everything, even molecular clocks, all of these, you know, oscillators, if you will, somehow all manage to couple in a way that produces coherent emergent phenomenon with that information processing capacities and information storing capacities. That are executing computations, and that is just sort of, you know, phenomenal to me. It's I think just really moving when you think about it that way. Mm-hmm. And sleep is a perfect, like you said, is a perfect example of that. There are so many things operating at so many timescales in sleep, and yet if you transform them the right way, you know, maybe they do all actually make sense, and that's how we can understand the coherence and the emergence that we see.
Yeah, just to add to that, I think that, I mean, what Alex expressed, what we all expressed, is sort of very much an SFI mm-hmm. view of the world, a more holistic, integrated way. And I think one of the interesting things in this workshop, and it's not atypical, but it's a little more in this workshop than in others, I think, is that I don't think most of the people in the coming to the workshop think in that way. And I think, and I, even though there's no tension, I don't think there's any, but I can sort of see that often there's talking like this because mm-hmm. of that, that most of them, and this is not a criticism, it's just a commentary, that are, you know, obviously we all look at things through our own specific lens, but one of the things obviously we try to encourage is to be, you know, to have a much more integrated, holistic view, and I'm hoping if we have further workshops or working groups on this, that we can move more in that direction.
And I agree, and I think, but it was nice that there was no tension, because it could have been tension.
No, that's what I expected,
and several of them, I'd say even the majority, I think, were receptive, actually, and enjoyed it. So I think it will shift that way in a way that's positive.
Yeah, absolutely.
And we didn't set it up to be tension-free either. We put together people with different perspectives. Yeah.
No, that's what's surprising. But it is interesting, this tension that is there between trying to get to the bigger picture versus the other side trying to get even deeper into the weeds.